please start your clocks. Thank you. Well, it's no coincidence that this video was published today on our YouTube channel. It's the 11th of February 2020, the 70th birthday of Evgeny Sveshnikov, the founder of Sveshnikov Defence. Magnus Carlsen, playing with the black pieces, essayed this opening and it was a great game. Just to give you a small background, I was there in the playing hall and MVL came around 15 to 20 minutes before the game. He sat on his board. He really wanted to beat Magnus and he opened the game with 1e4. Now Magnus replied with c5, and when Magnus does it these days, you can be sure that he's going to play the Sveshnikov. When you play e5, you do weaken the d5 square, but as we know, black gets a lot of things in return, most prominently free piece play and also control in the center. And so for that, he's ready to take on some weaknesses. And in the past, bishop g5 was the main move in this position, but now nd5 has been, you know, tried a lot in practice. It was Caruana who played it against Carlsen in their world championship match, and white has very good chances of fighting for an advantage. Now MVL was very well prepared. He was blitzing out his moves. Queen b4 was played here, looking at the d6 pawn. Queen b8 is a nice move. h4, h5. Now whenever white goes h4, black responds with h5 in order to stop white from gaining more space. This has all been seen before. Bishop d3, a6, knight c3. If you were to take on g6, I can take on b5, so knight c3, f5, bishop e3, bishop e7, and knight a4. And until this point, MVL didn't stop to think. You know, he was playing really quick. And it's very important that when you are watching such videos, that you try to think as to why a side didn't make a particular move. So for example here, knight into h4, why didn't black take this pawn? Now, because if knight b6 is a problem, then knight into g2 is very strong with a check, and then you pick up this bishop here, and then you play a5 with a tempo and get your rook out with rook a6. So king e2, knight e3 takes, and e4, a5, and everything comes with a tempo and black is better. If rook into h4 is something which Magnus was afraid of, then after bishop h4, knight b6, a5, queen c3, black can even give back the exchange and be completely fine. I think black is doing very well here. So in a way, knight into h4 should have been tried. Magnus played queen c7, and then now knight b6, rook d8, g3. Maybe g3 was not necessary, you could have just castled, but okay, g3 stops f4 as well. e4, bishop e2, knight e5, long castle, and here I was extremely surprised to see the move short castle. I thought to myself, what's going on? Can white not just take this pawn? And then I spotted knight d3 check. But then you can just take ed and say play a move like f4, and in this resulting position, it seems like white is clearly better. This pawn is blocked, these bishops are not too active. You can come back, pick up this pawn, put your bishop on f3, king b1, rook c1, slowly start playing on the queen side. It looks like a very difficult position for black. Also, bishop h5, maybe knight c4 is a possibility, because then after you take b5, and somehow black is able to recover the piece. Yet it seems like white retains an edge in this position as well. So you see, at many points there are certain questions that will come in your head. Why didn't Carlsen make this move, or why didn't MVL play this move? And you must analyze it deeply to understand the position better. In the game, king b1 was played, and now Magnus played very quickly. I like this phase of the game because bishop e8 first saves the bishop, And after rook c1, White's plan was pretty clear. You know, he will bring his other rook here and eventually try for c5 break. But what is Black going to do? That's what I was thinking. And Magnus instantly blitzed out the move bishop g6. This bishop looks passive here, but actually it's x-raying down this diagonal. King a1. And now another quick move, king h7, and this was impressive. You know, the king stands well on h7, away from the diagonal a2, g8, and there will be no tactics in future. Rook h d1, and this is where Magnus made another error by playing rook f e8. I think he should have played f4, which would have been very strong. Bishop f4 looks natural. If you take gf4, knight d3 is definite compensation. So bishop f4, knight d3, bishop d3, and here you sack an exchange, rook f4, and after e d3, this pawn is extremely strong, defended by the bishop. The other bishop can come to f6, and Black has excellent play. So what I'm trying to show by means of this analysis is, first of all, the Sveshnikov defense is extremely rich. Even a player like Carlsen, who studied it for the World Championship match, he does understand the patterns. That's why, you know, he could quickly get his bishop here, put his king on h7. This is all the result of his study that he has done in the past. He knows where his pieces belong. But yet, when you play in an actual game, you can go wrong often because it's just so complex and there are so many possibilities. And that's the reason why I wanted to bring this to your attention, and hope that you too will pick up the Sveshnikov defense. And no better day than today. It's the 70th birthday, as I said, of Sveshnikov, and we wish him a very happy birthday. Thanks a lot for giving us this wonderful opening.